Testing. Oh, wait, there we are. Hey, there we are. Hey, good morning, everyone. Happy Mother's Day to everyone. Come on in and have a seat. It is so good to see you here. And this is a great day to worship the Lord and a great day to honor the mothers and all the ladies in the church. It's a good day. Yeah, let's start off by honoring. Yeah, there we go. Well, again, if you're worshiping on the patio, it's a great day to be outdoors. For those of us that are in here, it's just a beautiful day. And those of you that are watching online, special welcome to you. Again, there's that link for the Connect card, the contact card. If you could just jot down how we can be praying for you this week, that would be amazing. We love connecting with you online. And I know a couple of people are here this morning that have watched some online, and now you're here in person, so special welcome to you. Well, hey, if you're able, we're going to ask you to stand together. We're going to begin with a time of worship and start off this Mother's Day by worshiping the Lord.
Amen.
Holy, holy.
sing holy, 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 to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Sings this morning, holy, 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 I want to see you.
Come on, let's give the Lord a clap offering. We want to see you, Lord. Lift it up.
Thank you for working in our lives.
Sometimes we might not see the work you're doing, but we know you are working day and night, Lord, on our behalf. So we thank you, Lord, that you are the way maker, the miracle worker. Come on, ladies, I want you to help me.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop
working. Come on, ladies.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. Stop.
Come on,
never
everybody
stop
now.
Working.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Light in the darkness, my God,
that is who you are.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 He's a way maker, miracle worker. Oh soul, my soul, are you weary and troubled? No night so dark that our eyes cannot see. There's light so bright as we look to our Savior. Life more abundant and free. Life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, the full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Oh God, our God, You are with us in darkness. Your word is a light, is leading us on. Our hearts can hear you, Heavenly Father, calling us all to your Son. Calling us all to your Son. For we turn our eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face.
Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Sing that again.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus, full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Amen. Go ahead and have a seat if you would. Again, let me welcome you to the Bridge Church. If you are new with us, you were handed a bulletin as you came in, and on the bottom of that, there's a little card that you can fill out, a Connect card. If you could do that and take it to a table in this lobby right after the service, we would love to give you a special gift, a Mother's Day gift, to thank you for visiting with us today. It's a nice little mug with chocolate inside. Every gift is better with chocolate inside. Have you noticed that? Well, good. Hey, but before Susan comes to do the kids' blessing and share some announcements, I want to share, and I know there are some guests with us this morning, but I have a couple of pieces of kind of family news to share with you that we want to talk through from the beginning. First, we've been talking a lot about and asking you to pray a lot for the process of renewing the lease. And I just want to let you know, we are very much at the last stages of that, to the point where we have signed it and we're waiting to get it back. And so, Lord willing, if we get it back, Dave Crego is going to come next Sunday and just give all the details. We just want to wait till everything's signed and sealed and then give all the details for what's going on. But thank you for praying. It's been quite an ordeal, quite a process, but it's good to be on the last stages of that. We'll give you the details next Sunday. Also, I wanted to let you know, and this is both kind of hard news and exciting news at the same time, but earlier this week, Jacob Brooks accepted a full-time position with youth ministry at a church not too far away. Jacob and Janessa are back there with Alana and Rosalina as well. And obviously, it's this great, we knew when we brought him on a couple of years ago part-time that this day was probably going to come. And we are, on the one hand, just so excited for Jacob and Janessa and the girls. And at the same time, we're grieving because we have just grown to love their family. And I know that raises the immediate question, okay, so what's next for student ministry? And we're excited about the answer to that because we kind of structured in such a way so that Dee Brunk was family ministry. He's working with Susan in children's ministry and Jacob in student ministry. And there's just an amazing team that has come around these students in our youth ministry. And so for the next season, Dee is going to move into more of a hands-on role with youth ministry, working with this really very gifted team that has come together around our students. So I'm going to ask you to be praying for Jacob and Janessa, and I'm going to ask you also to be praying for Dee and for our youth leadership team that will be stepping into this role. So Jacob's last Sunday is actually going to be 2 weeks from now. So on May 22nd, we're going to have Jacob and his family come up, and we will, you know, embarrass them horribly. No, we'll have them come up and just share some of their heart. And youth group that night is just going to be a big send-off to the Brooks family. I just encourage you over the next couple of weeks, if you see them, thank them, congratulate them, just remind them how deeply they are loved here at the Bridge Church. So what I'd like to do is just say a word of prayer, And you know, what a great day to pray. I mean, it's a great day to pray for Jacob and Janessa. It's also a great day to just express gratitude for the mothers that have raised us, or perhaps the ones that we're married to or that we look up to and call mom. It's also a good time to recognize this is a difficult day for a lot of people. And you know, honestly, we woke up, this is our first Mother's Day as empty nesters, and it's just kind of weird. Right? There's no kids to bring breakfast in bed. All you've got is a husband who gets up and runs off to church early in the morning. But I have some friends who would never dream of going to church on Mother's Day because it is just so painful. And it's a reminder of just how difficult, how joyous this day can be for so many people, but also how difficult. So let's just come together and pray as a church family for the Lord's grace and mercy. Father God, we do come today with hearts that are just full to overflowing as we think about your goodness. Father, for so many of us in this room, Mother's Day is just a wonderful time to reflect and be grateful and be joyful. But Father, we also know that for many, many people, this is a painful reminder of difficulties that we've faced in life. Father, you know our situations. Some who may have lost a mother, some who have struggled with infertility for many, many years, or some who have lost a child. There's so many stories to where Mother's Day can be such a painful reminder of difficult times in our lives. So Father, whether it's our joyous times or our painful times, we want to run to you in both of those. And we want to celebrate your good gifts in our lives and to honor those who are worthy of honor. Father, as we think of Jacob and Janessa, again, our hearts are just full with love and appreciation for this young couple and for Alana and for Rosalina. And Father, we're grateful not only for them, for this step that you've opened in their life, but Father, we are focused on your kingdom. And Father, we pray that you will bring many sons and daughters to glory as Jacob and Janessa continue in ministry, as they move on to a new work and a new opportunity to share your word, to make disciples who make disciples in a different ministry context. And I pray that you'll be with Dee and the student ministry team. I know they're getting together tomorrow night to come up with summer plans and all kinds of exciting things. And Father, we pray for our students. Father, that our students would not lose heart, but they would keep seeking you. And as I pray so many times for our children, that they would grow to love you with all of their heart, soul, mind, and strength. Father, that you would keep your hand on these students during this transition. So Father, again, we just come together excited to be here, excited to worship together, excited to see you at work in our church, in our midst, and we pray this in Jesus' name, amen. All right, speaking of kids, we're gonna ask the kids to come up. Susan's gonna come. Jeremy's already here. This is awesome. Come on, Alana's next up. All right, kids, come on up.
I was already right over there.
I know. Owen, I just love these guys. They're just—I mean, to me, they're not just job security; they're eternal security. I just love working with each and every one of them, and how precious their individual personalities are. And I often wonder what each of these are going to grow up to do for the kingdom of God, and that we all get to be a part of that. So let's pray for our kids. Almighty God, we do thank you for the privilege of telling the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord. We thank you that it's all of us and not just individuals that get to pour into the lives of these kids. But today, as these kids go back and they learn more about who you are and how much you love them, we just pray that the Holy Spirit, that you will open their hearts, that you will teach them, and that you will reveal to them how you want to be their helper. God, we thank you, and we just pray for each one of the leaders in kids' ministry, that you will speak through them, and that you will just bless each and every one that's on this stage, that's maybe hanging back a little bit. And we just thank you for the privilege of serving you through them, in Jesus' name. And all God's kids said, what happened to Jeremy? Did the rapture come? I closed my eyes and he's gone. Amen, right? Yeah. Amen. You are dismissed to go back to Bridge Kids. And youth. The youth made are dismissed. We just have a couple of quick announcements, and the first one is in 2 weeks. Not only is it the sad day of Jacob's last day, it is the International Food Fair. So I think that's my favorite, the tacos by Reuben. See, I get the Reuben thing right because he sends me jokes for Wednesday mornings, just saying. Tacos by Reuben. So the tickets are on sale today. And the tickets are $10 for adults, $5 for kids. You're just not going to want to miss it. It's a great time of fellowship as well. So get your tickets out on the patio today or online. And as Marcus said, today is Mother's Day. And I'm just going to be really selfish. Hi, Mom, because I know she's watching. We celebrate all women in our church. And we are just so thankful for each and every one. Would you read the verse that's on the screen? Let's read it together. Charm is deceptive and beauty does not last. But a woman who fears the Lord will be greatly praised. Proverbs 30 through 31. And so we want to honor all women. So we've got a couple of pictures to show you of life around the bridge with the women of the bridge. And it looks like we have a good time, right? So we are so grateful for all the women here. And speaking of women, we would like to invite Rachel to read scripture for us today.
Good morning, everyone. So this morning, the scripture reading is from the book of Mark, chapter 10, starting in verse 46. And they came to Jericho, and as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a great crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." And many rebuked him, telling him to be silent. But he cried out all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up, he is calling you." And throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. And Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" And the blind man said to him, "Rabbi, let me recover my sight." And Jesus said to him, "Go your way, your faith has made you well." And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, thank you. So, Father God, would you give us insight into your word this morning? Would you help us to hear, understand, and apply this to our lives? In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I've heard it said that when your desperation factor exceeds your embarrassment factor, then you're a candidate for grace. When your desperation factor exceeds your embarrassment factor, then that's when you receive the grace of God. That's what we see in this story, right? We talk about desperation. Desperate times call for what? Desperate measures. Do you know where that originates, by the way? Sometimes my mind works in that. Where did that saying come from? It goes all the way back to Hippocrates, this ancient Greek physician, the father of modern medicine, of Hippocratic oath fame, said that when there's an extreme illness, sometimes it requires an extreme cure, and that kind of became desperate times calls for desperate. It's just kind of interesting. But we know desperation, don't we? If you watch sports, you know desperation. Right? I mean, you get to the fourth quarter of a football game and things start getting desperate, don't they? I mean, this is when you see more blitzes. This is when you see the two-minute offense. This is when you see the Hail Mary passes. If you watch basketball, you get to the end of the game and things get desperate. The team that's losing is going to start full-court press. They're going to start fouling and hope the other team misses their free throws. If you're a student, you know desperation. Because we've all been there, right? You get down to your last final exam and you do the math, don't you? You add up all of your grades and you know exactly what score you need to get on this final exam in order to either get an A or maybe just pass the course. You know what grade you need to get. And desperate times calls for desperate measures. So you study overnight. You just start cramming all this information in your head. It's interesting to think through how desperation sometimes changes our focus. I mean, we have this canny ability to know when times are desperate or not. For example, before you get on a flight, a flight attendant's going to stand up and give you safety information for your flight. Nobody listens. There's no desperation at that moment. Now imagine you're at 30,000 feet in the sky, and you look out and you see smoke coming out of one of the wings, and the captain says, please pay attention to your flight attendant because they're going to give you important safety information. Suddenly, you're going to lean in and listen to what this flight attendant has to say because now it's desperate. Same thing with our prayer. It's Mother's Day. Many of you are going to get together around a table and you're going to enjoy a meal together, and someone's going to ask a blessing. But you don't really pray that prayer out of desperation. But when you get a phone call that starts with, okay, first of all, I'm okay, that's when you know things are not okay. Right? And suddenly when you pray at that moment, you pray differently because it's a desperate situation. The reality is this is true if you think about just hearing the gospel. Sunday after Sunday, people like me stand up in places like this and communicate the good news that even though we are separated from God because of our sin, Jesus came in our place as our substitute when he died on the cross so that when we put our faith in him, we can be forgiven. We can be forgiven for our sins. We can inherit eternal life. We hear this, and part of us thinks, oh, he said that last week, and he's going to say it again next week. Amen. Well, yeah, that's good that we say it every week, right? But there's a tendency to think, well, I don't have to respond yet. Maybe next week. Maybe next week. But you get in that moment where your life is hanging in the balance and you're just moments away from eternity with the Lord or an eternity of punishment in hell. And suddenly this gospel message becomes urgent because you're in a desperate situation. And it's when your desperation factor exceeds your embarrassment factor that you meet God's grace. We see that this morning. I don't mean to be using a pun here, but through the eyes of a blind man, Bartimaeus. It's interesting that he's introduced to us as Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, because Bar means son of. So his name means son of Timaeus, and then he's introduced as the son of Timaeus. It's like, this is Mr. Robertson. Son of Robert, right? you make those connections. But we'll see towards the end of the passage why it's actually very significant that we read his name and the name of his father. The context is interesting because it comes in a series of encounters, face-to-face encounters, that Jesus has with other people. We saw a couple of weeks ago that Jesus has a face-to-face encounter with a rich young ruler who comes with a question, what must I do to inherit eternal life? But he also wanted to keep his great possessions and had this divided heart, and he walked away sad. Last week, we saw an encounter by two brothers, James and John. Their question for Jesus is, can one of us sit on your right hand and the other on your left when you come into your glory? Can we be, we're not asking much. We just want to be the most honored, most important people in the kingdom. All that did was make the other 10 disciples really angry. But then we read of Bartimaeus. If the rich young man is on one end of the social spectrum, Bartimaeus is on the other. He has no possessions to cling to. But we see a man crying out in desperation. We see a man who's desperation factor exceeds his embarrassment factor, and he receives the grace of God. And as we work through this, there are three things we need to learn from this story, from this account. And I pray, my prayer is that as we go through these, that this will remind us that our situation is a little more desperate than we realize, and that we need to lean into these three truths. And the first one is this. The first thing we need from this is that we need insight more than we need eyesight. Let's read the beginning of this passage, and let me point this out to you. Look at the insight of Bartimaeus. And they came to Jericho. They obviously didn't stay there very long, because then it says, and as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a great crowd. Now let me pause. Do you remember why they're passing through Jericho? Do you remember what they're doing? He's on the way to Jerusalem, right? You know, as soon as we get to the end of this story and we start chapter 11, it's the triumphal entry coming into Jerusalem. So he is on a mission. He's on his way to Jerusalem, on his way to the cross. And some 15, 18 miles before you get to Jerusalem, you pass through Jericho. So as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a great crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out, say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And many rebuked him, telling him to be silent. But he cried out all the more, son of David, have mercy on me. This guy was, he was more desperate than he was embarrassed, right? I want you to notice the insight that he has. Notice that he has insight about his own need. He knows that he is a person in need. We read that he was blind. Now, we don't know if he was had always been blind. You know, in John chapter 9, we read a man who was blind from birth. We don't know if Bartimaeus was one that was blind from birth or somewhere in life lost his eyesight. The text actually leans a little bit towards he may have had sight and then lost it, but for the scope of the story, it really doesn't matter. But because here's this man, when you are blind, in this era, you were most likely a beggar. That every day would start out the same. You would wake up to total darkness. And someone you loved, a friend or a family member, would help you make your way. You would grab one of your few possessions. We know that he had a cloak. This may have been one of the few things that he had. And they would take them out alongside of the road next to the city gates, because that's where most people walked by. And he may have even spread out his cloak to be a place where if people were kind enough to drop coins as they walked by, he may collect them on his cloak until someone came to get him and bring him back home. And his whole life, his whole sustenance was dependent on the mercy of other people. And when you are blind and a beggar and you have nothing, and this is way before, you know, people trained seeing eye dogs, this is way before the Americans with Disabilities Act, you know, there were no ramps, there were no smooth areas to walk in. When you live, you are very well aware of your need. I need to see. And I look at Bartimaeus, I say, I mean, it seems like such a basic thing to point out. But how many times in our much more comfortable lifestyles are we just unaware of our needs? There's something about living in a community as nice as where we are privileged to live, with all the beauty around us and nicer cars and nicer homes, and many people, you know, even with margin in your life, and through some of that, it's easy to lose sight of our own need, the need that we have to be forgiven by God, the need that we have for the grace of God, the need to live in community, the need to have people in our lives who are going to love us and help us to be more like Jesus and pray with us, and all of these deep needs that can be masked. We get blinded. We have eyesight, but sometimes we lack the insight to know how desperate our situation is and how deeply we need the presence of the Lord and his grace and his mercy in our lives. But here's a blind man, and he knew it. He knew what he needed was the mercy from God. But not only did he have insight into his own condition, how desperate he is, he had insight into who Jesus is. It strikes me that here's this blind man sitting by the side of the road, and this great crowd comes by following Jesus. And it strikes me that this blind guy had more insight than many of the people that were walking with Jesus. That's why I say we need insight more than we need eyesight, because a lot of these seeing people just missed it. But notice what Bartimaeus says. First he calls out and says, Jesus. You want to do something interesting sometime? Read through the Gospels and see how many people call Jesus by name. Because it's not many. He calls out and says, Jesus. Then he uses a phrase we have not seen in the Gospel of Mark. Son of David. In other words, God made a covenant with David that there would always be one of his descendants on the throne. And so as they were waiting for this promised Messiah, there were certain things they were looking for. One is that he would be the son of David, a descendant of David coming to rule. And he cries out and he says, Jesus, son of David. In other words, I know who you are. And he says, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. You know, I just wonder, where did he get this insight? And I think through his day of waking up in darkness, carried out to the gates. And what do you do when you're a blind person and you're begging? You listen. You're listening for footsteps. You're listening for people walking by. And you can't help but hear conversations. And I just wonder what he may have heard, what he might have learned by just sitting and listening. I wonder if he heard the story that there was a man named Jesus who stood up in the synagogue and he read Isaiah 61, that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and I have come to proclaim liberty to the captives and give sight to the blind. And then go on to say that this scripture is fulfilled right now in your hearing. I wonder if Bartimaeus would have heard that. I wonder if he might have heard the story that we saw in Mark chapter 8 where Jesus healed a blind man. And first he saw people walking around like trees, but then finally he saw clearly. And I wonder if Bartimaeus heard enough of these stories to know that I believe that there's a man named Jesus who has the power to heal. And I also believe that he's kind enough and good enough that he just might heal me and I might regain my sight. I might be healed. And I love what he cries out. Have mercy. I mean, I read this passage. I was meditating on this passage so much, and it just struck me, how often should we just come before God and pray this prayer right here? Son of David, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Now this, what I'm about to tell you is insight that there's no way Bartimaeus would have had, but we see it later in Paul's writings. In Ephesians 2, he says this, but God, who is rich in mercy and out of his great love for us has made us alive together in Christ. And Bartimaeus, though there's no way his theology would have been that developed at that time, he had enough insight to know, I'm crying out for mercy from the one who is rich in mercy and has a great love for us and does wondrous things in our lives. He had great insight. He had insight into his own condition. But he also had insight into who Jesus is. There's one other area where I think Bartimaeus had insight. He had the insight to really seize the moment as it was given. He had the insight to know this is my opportunity to have an encounter with Jesus. As I found myself thinking this week, this guy carpe'd his diem. This was the day to seize, right? This is when Jesus was passing by. And he acted like, this is going to be my only opportunity. And you know what? Jesus passed by, went to Jerusalem, went to the cross. This was his only opportunity. This was his opportunity to have an encounter with Jesus. And this is why I started by talking about how many times we hear the gospel and think, well, I'll just wait till next time. I'll wait till next time. And you need to understand, one time when you hear the gospel, it's going to be the last time that you hear the gospel. And there's this desperation that we see in Bartimaeus that as he's sitting there and he hears not just the shuffle of a few feet, but he hears this great crowd coming and he hears someone say the name Jesus. He connects what's going on and he just begins to scream and cry out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy. And then notice what happens. The people around Jesus are like, oh, be quiet. I mean, this is Jesus coming by. He's, you know, the Messiah. He's going to be the king. Don't ruin the day with, you know, the riffraff screaming out. And this got really convicting, honestly, as I read this. Because I thought, how many times to those of us with eyes to see who are following Jesus, how many times are we a barrier for people coming to Jesus instead of a bridge for people coming to Jesus? I mean, our church is named The Bridge because this is our passion, to connect people to Jesus. And may we never be a body of Christ that inadvertently, unintentionally, or maybe even intentionally, become a barrier for people connecting to Jesus instead of the bridge to connect people to Jesus. May we never be people that say, because of the color of your skin or the language you speak, or maybe there's some sort of disability where you can't sit nice and quietly like you're supposed to in church, or whatever it is. May we never be those that communicate, you're not welcome here. But may we always be a bridge to the gospel, not a barrier to the gospel. And I just looked at these people saying, oh, come on. Don't ruin the day. I'll give you some coins. Just sit down and be quiet. Because we don't want Jesus seeing the likes of you. And I love Bartimaeus. So what does he do? He just yells out even louder. Keep your money. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. That's insight, isn't it? He knew his need. He knew who Jesus is. And he knew that this is my moment. This is the opportunity I have to be face to face with Jesus. So that's why what we need to learn from this passage is that we need insight more than we need eyesight. These people telling him to be quiet, they had eyesight, but they didn't know what was going on. We also need to know, we need to understand, this is the second thing we need from this passage, we need to understand the heart of Jesus. That's what we see as we keep moving. Jesus stopped and said, call him. And they called the blind man, saying to him, take heart, get up, he's calling you. And I love this reaction. Throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and he came to Jesus. And Jesus said to him, what do you want me to do for you? The blind man said to him, Rabbi, let me recover my sight. Jesus said to him, go your way, your faith has made you well. And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. I mean, he understood that Jesus has the power to heal, that Jesus has healed people, he's kind, he's merciful. But I think for us, we need to know a little bit more about the heart of Jesus. And I love what Jesus did. He's walking by, and I visualize things in my mind. You know, he's walking by with this great crowd. Here's this blind beggar yelling for mercy. There's people in Jesus' crowd saying, sit down and be quiet. And Jesus, the first thing he does is he just stops. Again, this is where I think visually, and I just see people in this crowd just like bumping into each other. Wait, we stopped. What happened here? Jesus stopped. I mean, don't miss that. Jesus was on his way resolutely to Jerusalem. He was on a mission to the cross to give his life as a ransom for many. But when Bartimaeus cried out, Jesus stopped. I thought about titling this, The Day the Sun Stood Still. Little play on words there, right? Because that's what the Son of God did. He stopped. And then he called. He called this man to come to him. Now, who do you think he called to bring him? The people that were saying, sit down and be quiet, right? I read this story and I just think of these guys saying, no, sit down, be quiet. We don't want Jesus to see the riffraff. He doesn't want anything. Okay, you know what? Come here. Like I was saying, Jesus wants to meet you right now. And they bring this blind man to Jesus. And by the way, the only way we come to God is the call of God. And when you hear the call of God, you come. So Jesus stopped. This is the heart of Jesus, right? This is how we can understand that what we know about Jesus is that he's one who stops and who calls. And here's Bartimaeus, blind man, standing before Jesus. And Jesus asked the question, what do you want me to do for you? Does that question sound familiar? I told you last week, remember this because you're going to hear it again pretty soon. You remember James and John? Jesus, will you do for us whatever we ask you to do? Jesus' response, what do you want me to do for you? Right hand, left hand, your choice. What about the rich young man that came before Jesus? I want to have eternal life, but I also want to have everything in this world. People that came to Jesus and walked away sad. And then here's Bartimaeus, and Jesus says, what do you want me to do for you? And he gives a very simple answer, doesn't he? Rabbi, let me recover my sight. This is what Jesus does in this story. He stops. He calls. And he heals. Because we read, immediately, he recovered his sight. He's not like the guy in Mark chapter 8 that saw people like trees and then he saw clearly. He immediately gained his sight. And how awesome that the first thing he saw was the face of Jesus. Isn't that an awesome thought? Some of you might be old enough or maybe Baptist enough to know the name Fanny Crosby. Anybody know that name? Kind of wave to you? Okay. She was, before there was Chris Tomlin, before there was Matt Redman, there was Fanny Crosby writing Blessed Assurance and all these great hymns that I sang growing up. But she was blind. And I read her biography one day and she used to say, what I love about being blind is that the first face that I'm going to see is the face of Jesus when I stand before him. That was Bartimaeus. His eyes were open, and there he was, face to face with Jesus. And this is my point. We need to understand the heart of Jesus. Now, does this mean that Jesus is going to heal everyone? Of course not. But let me tell you what we do know about Jesus, and I want to read you a passage from Hebrews chapter 4 that tells us about the heart of Jesus. Hebrews chapter 4, starting in verse 14. Since then, we have a great high priest, speaking of Jesus, who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. And the point that I want to make here is that we are never promised that you will always be healed of anything that you bring before the Lord. Jesus isn't, you know, the genie that you rub the lamp and he does your three wishes. We don't come to him like James and John saying, Jesus, will you do whatever we ask you to do? We are never promised healing in Scripture, a physical healing, but look what we are promised. We are told to come before the throne of grace with confidence because we know who the high priest is. We understand the heart of Jesus. And what do we promise? That we will receive mercy and find grace at our time of need. And I don't think we can read this story of Bartimaeus and say, well, when I pray, Jesus is going to stop and call and heal me of whatever I'm asking him about. But we are guaranteed this, that we will receive mercy and find grace when we come confidently before the throne of grace in our time of need. And this is the heart of Jesus. We need to understand he's not too busy. He's not preoccupied. There's not too much going on in his world that he doesn't have time for you. And it's not that your needs are too big or too small. He invites us to come with confidence before the throne that we may receive mercy and find grace at those points of need in our life, because that's who Jesus is. And that's the heart of Jesus that calls us to come to him. Let me show you one more thing that we need from the story. We need insight. We need to know our situation. We need to know who Jesus is. We know that this is our moment. We need to understand the heart of Jesus, that he's one who's going to stop and call and show mercy and grace at our time of need. We also need to live, this is the best way I could find to describe this, we need to live at that intersection of our faith and God's mercy. Here's what I mean. When Jesus heals him, did you notice what he said? He said, "Go your way, your faith has made you well." That just brings up a whole conversation, doesn't it? It's his age-old conversation. Was Bartimaeus healed because God has mercy or because he had faith? And the passage seems to say, well, it's at an intersection of both of those. And here's why this is an important conversation and a difficult one to fully answer in about a minute and a half. So we're not going to fully answer it, because it's one that you just keep wrestling with. We can never say to someone, the reason you weren't healed is because you don't have enough faith. And if you only had more faith, and God would, I mean, look at this story. Jesus said your faith made you well. So obviously you don't have enough faith. That we dare never say that to anyone. Sometimes out of God's sovereign plan and purposes, he allows us and enables us to go through a time of difficulty, a time of suffering, so that he can work his purposes within us. And it's these times that often grow and strengthen our faith, and our faith is deeper than it's ever been at any other time in our lives. And it's, you can't look at Scripture and say, if you just had more faith, Jesus would have healed you, or healed your child, or healed your parent. Or you see, there's this God's mercy. Ultimately, we are healed or we find grace because we serve a God who is rich in mercy and has a deep love for us. But we are called to approach him in faith. And at some point, there's this intersection. And this is where Bartimaeus, he was sitting by the road, but he was at this intersection of the mercy of God and his faith in what Jesus could do. And that's where he found the grace of God. And so we need to live constantly dependent, constantly crying out for the mercy of God, but in such a way that it strengthens and builds our faith in who Jesus is. And so we walk in faith, trusting for God to work according to his mercy. And it goes on to say, your faith, go your way, your faith has made you well. That phrase, made you well, is interesting. I use the English Standard Version. Your version of the Bible may say something different. It may say, your faith has healed you. It's an interesting word in the Greek. Actually, this came up in our life group conversation earlier this week. It's the Greek word sozo, which can talk about a physical healing, can also talk about a spiritual healing. I mean, you could translate this, your faith has made you well, your faith has healed you. You could also translate this word, your faith has saved you. Those are all proper ways to translate this Greek word. And it's interesting to see, not only did Bartimaeus receive physical sight, but Jesus said, go your way. He said, you know what? He said, go on your way. Your faith has made you well. In other words, you are healed. Go do whatever you want to do. And so what does he do? Immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. Go your way. Do whatever you want. I know what I want. I want to follow you. And he goes from being the beggar on the side of the road to the man following Jesus on the road. I mean, can we use a little divine imagination here? Where does Jesus go from here? To Jerusalem. What's the next thing we read? Waving palm branches, right? Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name. Is it reasonable to deduce that Bartimaeus could have been there with the palm branches? This man who 15 to 18 miles ago was a blind beggar, and now he has eyesight to go with his insight, and he's following Jesus, saying, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. That's powerful, isn't it? I don't know how long he would have hung around Jerusalem that week, but he could have been there for the crucifixion. He could have seen the evidence of the empty tomb. He just determined in his heart, not only am I now a guy who can see, I'm a man who's going to follow Jesus. As a matter of fact, it's really interesting. Out of every person that Jesus healed, there's only one that has a name. There's a man with a withered hand. There's the daughter of Jairus. There's a woman with a blood disorder. There's a paralytic with four friends. And then there's Bartimaeus. Not only do we get his name, we get his dad's name. And you have to wonder why. Out of all the healings, why do we get this one name? The best answer you can find is that when Mark sat down to write this account, this gospel account, to believers in Rome that were predominantly Gentile, suffering under the persecution of Nero, that the name Bartimaeus would have meant something to them. That he would go on to have a role in the church so that people 30 years later would know who Bartimaeus is and maybe even know something about his father. In other words, when I look at this, I think this is a man who didn't just follow him and wave a palm branch. This is a man whose life was forever changed and kept following Jesus. That's quite a story, isn't it? That here's a man whose desperation factor exceeded his embarrassment factor. He's yelling like crazy, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy, be quiet. I'm not going to be quiet because here's Jesus and my life needs to be changed. And not only did he gain his physical sight, but he spent the rest of his life, as far as we know, following Jesus. He followed Jesus on the way. And by the way, we said, you know, this is the last person we read of Jesus healing. Once he gets to Jerusalem, you don't see him cleansing lepers and healing. This is it. This is the last healing miracle. Miracles in Jerusalem have to do with more like cursing fig trees and things like that. But you don't see people being healed after Jesus walks by the gate in Jericho and stops and calls and heals a blind beggar. So as we hear this story, here's where I hope it connects with us. It is so easy for us to just kind of go through our lives. I mean, we're busy, we got things going on, bills to pay, we got things from work, we got social, you know, there's all these, our schedules fill up pretty quickly. But do we ever stop to realize how desperately we need the mercy of God, the grace of God on a daily basis? Do you ever just stop and ponder, have the insight to say, I know my needs, I know who Jesus is, and I know that I need to seize the opportunity to be with the Lord? Do we ever stop and ponder that when we pray, Jesus is not an uncaring ear off in the distance somewhere? We're not just praying to the walls or the ceiling or talking to ourselves. Do you ever stop and consider that when we pray, that the very God of the universe stops, hears, calls, shows mercy and grace at our time of need? You ever consider what life looks like at that intersection between our faith and the mercy of God? And just say, you know, I want to live right there where I keep walking in faith and I experience God's mercy. That's where I want to live. And I hope, if nothing else, that this short story of a guy with a funny name that refused to be quiet because he was desperate, that this will cause us to see that we need to live with a little more intentionality and a little more focus on who Jesus is and what he's calling us to do. As we close this morning, we're going to do something we haven't done in over 2 years. We're going to take up an offering. We have not passed a plate in years. I see everybody scurrying, so I want to go ahead and mention this. So I want to close, and worship team, you can come on up. I'm going to just have a word of prayer. And then, I haven't said this in years, but our ushers are going to come and receive the offering this morning. And I just want to say, you know, as we do this, you know, throughout this pandemic, when things were shut down and everyone was scattered, and churches like ours had a very legitimate fear of what in the world are we going to do, it is so amazing that through the mercy of God and the generosity of his people, we've just kept moving forward. And so praise the Lord for his, yes. And I know it's a little awkward sometimes to introduce an offering, but this is really something to celebrate, just the Lord's provision for his church over the past few years. Let me pray. Father God, first of all, I thank you for your word and for this story. I thank you that the heart of Jesus is one to stop the crowd and to meet the need. And so, Father, as we come before you with our own needs, it's so easy to think that you're either too distant or too busy, or that you don't really care, or my needs are too insignificant to bring before you. But you promised us. We have a high priest who sympathizes with our weaknesses, and that we are to come with confidence before the throne of grace so that we might receive mercy and find grace at the time of our need. So, Father, whatever it is that's burdening us this morning, whatever it is in our lives where we need to cry out and say, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Father, it could be a sin issue. It could be a struggle going on at work or at school. It could be a relational crisis. It could be a sadness in our heart. Father, whatever our need is this morning, we just want to bring this before you and lay it at your feet at the throne of grace and find grace and receive mercy at this point of need for us. And Father, we do celebrate that today we can, it's safe enough to pass a plate and receive an offering. And Father, we pray that you will take the little happy meals that we're able to give and use them for great things for your kingdom. Father, as we move next week towards our Mission Sundays, and we can see how even the financial gifts that we give, how you use those through ministries, not just here in the Conejo Valley, but literally around the world. Father, would you be honored as we worship you, not just through the teaching of your word and the singing of songs, but through our giving as well. Would this be honoring to you? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Have mercy on us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Who made the blind to see is moving here in front of me, moving here in front of me. The one who made the deaf to hear is silencing my every fear, silencing my every fear. I believe in you, I believe in you. You're the God of miracles. I believe in you, I believe in you.
Let's all rise and sing together.
The one who does impossible is reaching out to make me whole. Is reaching out to make me whole. The one who put death in his place. His life is flowing through my veins. His life is flowing through my veins. I believe in you. I believe in you. You're the God of me.
The question, what should I do for you, Lord? You know our hearts, you know our needs, and we place it at your feet, Lord.
The God who was and is to come, the power of the risen one. To life, you're the God of miracles. You're the God of miracles. Oh, the God who was and is to come, the power of the risen one, the God who brings the dead to life. You're the God of miracles. You're the God of miracles. Confess this morning and tell them, the Lord, I believe in you. I believe in you. You're the God of miracles.
And I know you're working in my life, Lord.
I believe in you. I believe in you. You're the God.
Impossible for you, Lord. Why don't we sing it one last time?
I believe in you. I believe in you. You're the God of miracles. Yes, you are. I believe in you. I believe in you. You're the God of miracles.
What a great day. Amen. Can we say thank you to the worship team, by the way? This is great. And have you noticed that worship is always better when the drummer's wearing a nice orange shirt? That's just such... Way to go, Carter. I'm loving it, loving it. Hey, just a reminder, next week we begin our Mission Sundays. We've got a guest speaker named Steve Larson.
You might know him.
We're excited about that. Patty Larson will be here as well. Somebody help me. Sister-in-law? Okay, thank you. His sister-in-law, I'm always so hesitant to say it because I know I'm going to get it wrong. Obviously the new guy here, right? Anyway, we're excited to have Steve Larson back with us next Sunday. And Patty will be here as well. And then the following Sunday, it's going to be a combined service on the 22nd because we're doing the International Food Fair. Remember to pick up your tickets on the way out. And happy Mother's Day, everyone. Have a great day celebrating in the Lord. God bless. We'll see you soon.